What opens the path more than anything else, if you love the truth, what, truth of anything, for what it is, not what we get from it.
Welcome, friends, to this special, extra long, extra deep edition of Insights at the Edge. My guest is someone I've had the honor of speaking to before, and each time I'll use the word that occurs to me, it's illuminating. A.H. Almaas, that's the pen name for Hamid Ali. Let me tell you a little bit about Hamid. Born in Kuwait, he's been living in the United States since he was 18 years old, and he's the founder of the Diamond Approach to Self-Realization, a contemporary teaching that developed within the context of both ancient spiritual teachings and current theories of modern depth psychology. He's the author of more than 20 books, and I'll share with you some of my favorites. This will also, I'll let you know that I'm a true spiritual nerd, because these are some of the books I bring with me when I go on vacations and I have the chance to read them over again for the third time, fourth time. The Unfolding Now, Runaway Realization, Space Cruiser Inquiry, and a new book, it's called Nondual Love, Awakening to the Loving Nature of Reality. And that's going to be the theme of our conversation. Just to tell you a little bit more about Hamid, with Sounds True, he's created in-depth learning programs, one on presence, another series that's an introduction to the Diamond Approach, and a series on endless enlightenment, the view of totality in the Diamond Approach. And he's really someone that I look to as a guide, as a way shower. Just to say it plainly, I think of him as a type of spiritual genius. And I'm so grateful to have the chance now to talk to him about his new book on non-dual love. Hamid, welcome.
Good to be with you, Tami, again.
Thank you.
Old friends.
There's so many different ways that I could ask you to introduce the Diamond Approach, but I want to ask you to do that by referring to the near-death experience that you write about quite in some detail in Nondual Love. It's in the final chapter on the gift of grace, and my question is, how did this near-death experience that happened to you in your early 20s, how did it change you? You write that before the experience, you weren't particularly interested in spirituality as a focus of your attention. But then afterwards, the Diamond Approach, this path started emerging. What happened during your near-death experience that created this shift, if you credit it at all with the shift?
It was a near-death experience, but different from what you hear and read about near-death experiences. People talk about seeing a tunnel and light in the tunnel and this and that. You know, very well known, many people have that experience. My experience wasn't like that. I didn't see a tunnel, I didn't see a light, I didn't see, you know, any of that. And more, I just was myself in some kind of spacious, peaceful medium expanse. And what I was a presence that had faceted, colored facets of different kinds. So I felt like I'm a diamond presence. And diamond in the sense of faceted, clear, sharp, but also presence, being that presence. and different diamond that in time afterward I learned each one had a meaning, you know, which I didn't know at the time. I was just feeling that. But I was in this vastness, this beautiful, peaceful, very completely black vastness. Like William Shatner writes about his experience looking at the blackness of space when he went up in the market. And he said it was empty, terrifying. But the blackness I saw was peaceful, friendly, blissful, and felt completely inviting. And I felt I could go just there into that darkness and to that universe of intimacy. But then when I looked, I was like high up, you know, from my body. I looked down, see my body, see the world, see the streets and all that, the people. And so I said I could go one way or another. It felt like I had two ways I can go. I can go, leave the body, finish, go into that blissful expanse, or I could go back into the world. And then as I was contemplating that, I noticed two facets begin to shine much more strongly. A pink one and a yellow one. Beautiful pink, beautiful yellow. And the feeling is love and joy. Later on, I learned that pink is one way of experiencing love, and yellow is the color when you experience spiritual joy. And the pink and joy basically made the choice to go into the body, to both for love and joy and to bring love and joy.
As you talk about it, you know, it sounds a little bit to me, your life story here, hearing this, like a sci-fi movie in a way, meaning this near-death experience, and now the human is a diamond faceted presence, transformed totally, and now communicating a path that's helpful to other people. I'm wondering how you make sense of this transformation, turning point in your life.
Well, I mean, it took time for me to really learn the importance of that experience and how it was a fork, sort of, or some kind of a transitional place. I wasn't overtly interested in spiritual things at that time. I was interested more in knowing what is the truth about things, about reality, about the world. And this experience, how it changed me, is that afterward, my life moved in such a way where the truth of reality became an inner truth. Before that, I was studying physics and math science and all. That's how I thought I'm going to find out the truth of reality. So it's the same love and interest in the truth, but got shifted, turned around inward into what is the inner truth of reality, not what can be experimented on and measured physically, you know, from earlier on. But I didn't recognize it as an inner truth till that time happened.
And I want to ask you two further questions about that. Yeah. One is, I've heard you describe the work of deepening our understanding of the Diamond Approach as inner work. That the school based on the Diamond Approach is an inner work school. What do you mean by inner work?
Well, I mean, that's a description that Gurdjieff started, that expression, inner work. Inner work means working about your innards, about your subjective experience. So it's not work in the sense most people know what work is. You go to work, you make and earn a living, or be an artist, produce this, all that kind of work. But this work is working with one's consciousness, with one's experience, and how one is experiencing oneself and the world and reality, and working with it to sort of understand it, to penetrate it, to eliminate it. So it's inner in that sense. It's basically work that happens within the consciousness about the content of consciousness itself.
And I've also heard you describe the diamond approach as a path that's attractive to people who love the truth. And you talked about how you were looking for truth originally, external objects through physics, and then after this experience, inwardly. What does it mean to love the truth?
Well, many people love the truth, but they don't necessarily love it the way I think about it. Loving the truth, you know, many people come to spiritual work feeling many ways that the movement inward, the movement toward liberation happened, like wanting freedom, wanting enlightenment, wanting liberation, wanting freedom from suffering, you know, wanting the meaning of reality, wanting God or divine, wanting union with the ultimate, all these things that people come, go inward. For me, the way it happened and the way the path that developed became the central organizing principle is that what opens the path more than anything else, if you love the truth, truth of anything, for what it is, not what we get from it. So love is inherently, if you know what love is inherently selfless, inherently giving. So loving the truth means loving it for what it is, loving the truth, not because I want something from it. It's just curiosity and a drive to understand, to apprehend, not mentally, but through a direct, immediate intimacy with whatever truth I'm, and so the truth is not just one thing. Many teaching take the truth means the ultimate truth, knowing the Brahman or the Dharmakaya or the divine essence. You know, in the path I'm working with, the truth can be start with a very simple thing. It's the truth that there is talking happening between you and me. That is true. You know, there is a truth that we want to discuss something about love. That is truth. And then there's the truth of what is love? And there's the truth of what is the nature of the universe? There's the truth. I mean, one truth, for instance, is the world is made out of atoms. That is a certain kind of truth. It's not false. It's true. But there is also another truth, that the world is made out of consciousness. And then, what does that mean? What is that truth of consciousness? And so, loving truth means being curious about it, whatever way we find it, whatever way truth appears in our experience. All the truth and all its love, they're all interconnected, and the connecting thread is the truth, the fact that they are true. In our world these days, they say truth is being lost. There's a lot of misinformation and all of that. That can happen, of course, about external thing, but no misinformation can deviate from the fact of knowing what I'm feeling, what I am. See, my perception of myself, my perception of reality is beyond the stories. And that happens by following what is the truth. And so the truth has many it's a continuum of levels of what truth is, from what I call the relative truth, which is what most people know. It's true. We are talking true. This is just such a time. You're in Canada, I'm in the US. That's all true. To the truth of the hearts are open. There's openness, there's interest. And then there's the truth of where is this interest? Where is this curiosity coming from? And if you go into that, that is also a truth. And then we find out that it's coming from some deep place beyond the mind. And that is truth. And what is that? That is truth. Until we get to what spiritual teaching called the ultimate truth and all that, that's truth too. So truth is, for me, is a continuum. And all of them, all the level of the degrees of truth have in them the common thing is truth. And truth, if we really follow it, if we are curious about it, if we love to find out what it is, and we manage to really find out what is the truth of anything we're exploring, it's liberating. It's inherently illuminating, and that illumination is inherently liberating. So it brings up all what people want, the liberation, the meaning of life, and the, you know, and enlightenment, realization, ultimate truth, all that appear as we explore what the truth of anything. We just go deep into it.